I bought BCH thinking it's BTC. Selling all BCH for the real
Bitcoin.
Bitcoin
Cash is peer-to-peer cash. BTC is not.
BCH is also objectively more Bitcoin than BTC.
Rational people will not pay even $1 per transaction and will not wait 1 minute.
You can list the few technical pros of BTC versus BCH all you want. It won't help you buy a coffee with it.
In 2 years, we'll all be coining BCH.
The block size limit will go down in history as one of the worst things to ever happen to
Bitcoin. It will end up as Dr. Craig Wright predicted. BTC will become a sidechain of BSV that has no scale and has no utility and is a dead man walking.
Sorry, but BSV is the real Bitcoin. BSV has the utility.
BTC Bitcoin
is the real Bitcoin.
BTC is not.
BCH is very close to being centralized. Look at the mining pools.
BTC because they want high fees. That's why I recommend Bitcoin Cash.
It will end up with Dr. Craig Wright predicted. BTC will become a sidechain of BSV, the real Bitcoin.
Just like nationalism and religion, too many people are emotionally attached to a specific coin without critically evaluating its merits. BCH works great. BTC is slow, expensive, and unreliable.
Hey guys, you are watching Crypto Corner Podcast episode 62. I'm your host, OJ Jordan. There's been a lot of speculation and heated debates on social media as to which is the real Bitcoin, with a very great deal of FUD and some very bold claims made by the creators and supporters of both Bitcoin Cash forks. There's two of them, BCH and BSV, with either of them saying that their version, in fact, holds the true essence of what Bitcoin was meant to be in the first place. But does it really matter? Well, as an investor in Bitcoin, I really want to know that the coin I invest in has a future and a true potential and can really stand against such speculations and manipulation, especially since one of the most popular websites, Bitcoin.com, belongs to the biggest supporter of Bitcoin Cash, Roger Ver. And for the past 2 years, we've seen tons of misinformation and heavy marketing campaigns directed against Bitcoin, misleading the newbies into thinking that the future belongs to Bitcoin Cash and that Bitcoin is a slow, unusable, and basically a failed project. To help me understand what's going on with Bitcoin today, I asked a programmer and a very well-known fellow YouTuber and educator, Ivan on Tech, to join me for a quick chat about the current state of development and to give us his opinion on where things are going. Bear in mind, Ivan is a very fast speaker and he had some really great insights to share, so sit tight, pay close attention, and enjoy this conversation. Hello, Ivan, and thank you for joining me today.
Good to be here. Good to be here, man.
Let's get started. What is going on with Bitcoin today and the war, I would say, that is going on?
I mean, it's not really a war, but let's talk about Bitcoin. Well, it's growing. We have Lightning Network being developed rapidly, getting more and more user-friendly. We have all kinds of different developments when it comes to development community, when it comes to use cases, when it comes to network capacity, because we can offload transactions to Layer 2. So all in all, if you just look during at the past year, we've seen an incredible amount of developments and progress. So that is very, very good. Well, regarding the forks, we saw so many forks of Bitcoin, by the way. Of course, you know Bitcoin Cash, Bitcoin SV, but then there's also Bitcoin Diamond. There is all kinds of Bitcoins. We have a new Bitcoin called Bitcoin Hex that's not really built on Bitcoin. But all in all, it is very lucrative for people to try and hijack the Bitcoin brand. So keep that in mind, that if I create a coin and it's called Bitcoin something something, in a few months, it might be quite high up on coin market cap. And I think Bitcoin Diamond and Bitcoin Private, whatever you have, they really showed it, because you look at their market cap a few months back, maybe 6 to 8 months, it was quite high. Why? Because it's called Bitcoin. It has nothing to do with Bitcoin really, but it's called Bitcoin. So whenever we're talking about Bitcoin, keep this in mind, first of all. Second, why did the Bitcoin Cash get created? Why did Bitcoin SV get created? Well, obviously, they needed some kind of story. You cannot just take Bitcoin and call your coin also Bitcoin. They need some kind of story. And so Bitcoin Cash story is that we are the real Bitcoin because we increased the block size. And This block size debate, which is a technical debate, has been going on for a very long time. It started in 2014, really. And we've seen other forks as well, like Bitcoin Unlimited, that also forked from Bitcoin in the early days between the past bull market and the past bear market and past bull market, basically between 2013 to 2017. So Bitcoin Unlimited was a thing because they raised the block size. And basically, that could allow for more transactions on the Bitcoin network. But it also required a hard fork. Basically, you needed to change a fundamental rule of Bitcoin in such a way that everyone needs to update. And if someone doesn't update, they're no longer part of the same network.
Huh? It was basically going to do what Bitcoin Cash did in the end. And this is why Roger Ver actually jumped in the bandwagon with Bitcoin Cash, because it actually managed to do what Bitcoin Unlimited was supposed to. Now, let me just interject here. What is the argument against increasing the blocks in terms of BTC supporters and developers? Yes. They did not really want to increase the blocks from 1 megabyte, which was a limit which Satoshi himself implemented in the early days. And as far as I know, it's to do with security of the network. But explain to us exactly what is the risk with increasing the block size.
There are three reasons. Reason number one is hard fork that I mentioned. You don't want to do breaking changes because Bitcoin should be stable. We shouldn't be changing things back and forth all the time, increasing, decreasing block size, changing key parameters. And it is just the philosophy of Bitcoin. It is immutable. I mean, if you want, you can even change 21 million cap with a hard fork. So if we start forking and doing these fundamental breaks in the protocol that everyone needs to upgrade in order for them to stay on the network, it just sets a bad culture of having breaking changes. And this is something that Bitcoin should not be doing. We should not have breaking changes, number one. Number two is network capacity. Basically, when you have larger blocks and when your only philosophy is to increase the block size, it means that as the network grows, we will just be having bigger and bigger block sizes. Now, we have a 10-minute block time, meaning that when 10 minutes have passed, there's a new block coming out. Imagine you have gigabytes of blocks. If you just keep this in mind and you think 20 years into the future, the blocks will just keep growing, 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 and suddenly you need to transport all of these blocks across the entire world to all the nodes. They also need to have computing power to validate the block, and if it is several gigabytes, who knows how long time it will take. And that leads to centralization too. So both network limitation and also you need to be verifying. And obviously, if you need to download several gigabytes of block and then you need to verify it, you cannot do it on your own computer. So it is philosophical reasoning as well. So all in all, hard fork. Number two, network. Number three, just processing power and centralization. And so therefore, the philosophy of Bitcoin is to go to layer two, that you have Lightning Network and other solutions. Also, in a way, Bitcoin has increased the block size by introducing SegWit and basically taking the signatures from the transactions and putting them in their own separate place, which means that because once you as a node, once you have verified all transactions, you don't need to have signatures there no more because you have trust in what you're seeing is correct. So therefore, they have basically split up so that the signatures is in one place and transactions in another place. So that when you have verified everything with signatures, you don't need to keep them in the same place as transactions. So, and that was actually possible with a soft fork. So you didn't need to have breaking change. So all in all, in a way, we have increased the block size and it's just philosophical differences, but also there is an incentive to take Bitcoin brand and create a new coin. So therefore, to me, it's natural that people will do that. And also Bitcoin should be able to survive, which it does. Like, we don't care that somebody has taken the name and now we have several Bitcoins because Bitcoin is still here. Bitcoin is still the Bitcoin that everyone goes to. And while there is an incentive to create new Bitcoins, you need to be thinking long-term, like, is it gonna survive? And really Bitcoin, Satoshi's vision shows why it is unsustainable because, like, okay, let's say I'm a big blocker. Do I go to Bitcoin Cash or Bitcoin Satoshi's vision? In a few months, maybe Satoshi's vision breaks up into Bitcoin, into real Satoshi vision and not real Satoshi vision. So you realize, as soon as you start messing around with the fork, there will be 10 other forks that will claim that they are better than your fork. So therefore, it is another argument to why you should not do breaking changes.
Okay, so let me go to the transactions, the fees mainly, because this is right now again, a growing issue. I'm sharing my screen. Hopefully you can see it here. We can see the transactions at the moment. We have an increase. Bitcoin jumped in the last few days. It had, you know, quite a lot of volume again going into the trading and everything. And again, we're seeing a big increase in the fees. Currently, today, we are paying 160 Satoshi per byte for you know, a transaction to be included in the next block, or in the next 60 minutes, it's 153 Satoshi. Only a few days ago, actually a week ago, it was 3 Satoshi per byte. Now, this is a huge jump again, and this is despite having SegWit and despite, you know, hoping that with the SegWit we have already sorted out the fees problem, which was, you know, for a long time we paid very low fees, but and we don't even have that many transactions that are unconfirmed. At the moment, it's around 20,000 in the mempool, so it's not a congested network. What can happen if we get, again, Bitcoin going up to, you know, ridiculous highs like 15, 20K and we're having 100,000 or more unconfirmed transactions? Are we going to see the fees going up again to like $50, $100 even?
So what you just showed is the fact that when people use Bitcoin more, there are higher fees, and it's just natural because obviously during the past days, we've seen this rally in the markets and people use it more. So when people use it more, there are higher fees. Obviously, we don't want to be in a situation like 2017 where it was $50 for sending a transaction. It's not something that is good. And hey, nobody thinks it's good. Do Bitcoin developers think it's good? Absolutely not. And therefore, we're pushing for layer two. Therefore, transactions that are, for example, microtransactions that really you don't need to have high level security instantly. You can have it in your channel and then it will be synced to the real blockchain. Those transactions should be off chain. So this is the, sorry man, my TV is going down here. So this is the philosophy of layer two. And hopefully we will be at the point where we see the next bull run, we are prepared, because last time we weren't prepared. Absolutely true, we weren't prepared. So in that sense, I do hope that with Lightning Network and all the developments we see right now, that it won't happen. And I don't think it will happen. Now, you also need to, there's no perfect solution, like there's no perfect world. Obviously, everyone would like to have a network with no breaking changes, with no culture of changing important things, and at the same time, everything scales perfectly and it's so easy to scale, but that world doesn't exist. So I think a lot has to do with weighing pros and cons and what is the best for the long term.
Okay, so Lightning Network again, because you mentioned a few times now, why is Lightning Network still not being rolled out properly? I mean, it's not really being used widely, and it's been trying to do that for the last 3 years. It, you know, it's been preparing for a longer time, but really we were hoping that by the end of 2018, we would have Lightning Network fully operational and a lot of people will be using it, thus lowering the fees. Why is that still not happening?
Well, it is happening. Just a few weeks ago, I did a stream on my channel where I bought things with an easy app or on my phone with a Lightning Network. So it is happening. But I think the bigger question we need to ask is why people are not using Bitcoin? Because that is the biggest question. And then Lightning Network is just a matter of, you know, you have a Bitcoin wallet and it's easy to have a Lightning wallet. So I don't think the question is why are people not using Lightning? Because the big question is why the hell are people not using Bitcoin? Because if Bitcoin would be used everywhere, well, then Lightning would also be used everywhere. And so this is the question that I think we need to be talking about globally, because at the end of the day, it's all about how can we help people in different countries that where you don't have economic freedom, and how can we spread the financial inclusion to more countries. So I think this is the biggest debate, and this is the biggest focus I think we should be having. And you look at big companies such as MasterCard or Visa. They're very successful right now. Everybody's using them. Everyone is comparing Bitcoin to them. But realize they started in the 50s, and it was 70 years ago. And we're just 10 years in. So all in all, number one, the big question is why are people not using Bitcoin? And I think one of the answers is that we're so early on.
Yes, also I think a big reason is, at least with people that I speak to, they still want it to be a store of value for them. They see it as Bitcoin, you know, having a potential to increase a lot, and they just don't want to spend. Yes.
Could be. And that's valid.
And that's what pretty much everyone is saying. I don't want to spend my Bitcoin. I keep
it. Right. And, you know, to me, it's also valid. is because I agree. Why would I keep it? Why would I spend it if I think it will increase in the future? And therefore, and store of value, you should not underestimate that that property. I mean, think about all the people living in countries with unstable economical systems. Like I'm from Belarus myself when I was a kid, where nobody has Belarusian rubles really. You go to dollar, you buy an apartment, you buy it in dollar. You don't buy it in rubles. And so just being a store of value and having an alternative that people can have instead of going into their own fiat that is worthless, don't underestimate that. Of course, it would be great if we could use it for microtransactions. So that is why we have layer two and other things. But all in all, let the market choose what they want to do. If the market thinks that, hey, it's going to go up, so I better use some other money, perfect. And you know, there is this law, I think it's called Gresham's Law. Google Gresham's Law. It basically says that bad money will always be used more than good money. Why? Because nobody wants to spend good money. Everyone wants to hold good money. But bad money will be spent. And if you read on Wikipedia, you will see a lot of historical examples when you have bad money basically being circulated more than good money. And something else that is important that I want to recommend to your viewers is to check out the Bitcoin Standard, the book. I think it's interesting how they talk about different ways that Bitcoin will be used in the future and different roles it can play. I mean, sure, daily transactions, wonderful. I hope it will happen. But maybe it's more like store of value, or maybe it's just an alternative to fiat that people can go to, but fiat is still around. So Bitcoin doesn't replace fiat completely. And who knows where we're going to be. Man, it's like talking about the internet in the 80s. If you were in the 80s and we spoke about the internet, would you say that we will have Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, we're talking to each other across the world through the internet? I don't think so. So this is kind of similar here. The market still hasn't decided what it wants to do with crypto, and that is what we still have to see.
Okay, well, very good point. I know that you are starting your show in just a few minutes, so I'm not going to keep you much longer. One thing also before we leave, you mentioned store of value as well, and bad money being more used than good money. But can Bitcoin be a real store of value if it doesn't get to the point of being used as money? I mean, if you don't have enough user adoption, can Bitcoin sustain that value that people are putting in it? Like, can it really be a store of value in the longer term if it doesn't get used?
Look at gold. How is gold used? Well, it's used in electronics, in jewelry. Now, is the price of gold reasonable if it's only used in a few things like jewelry and electronics? Absolutely not. A large percentage of the gold price is because people believe it's a store of value, and because people know it's limited in supply and so forth. So the same is with Bitcoin. I mean, realize Bitcoin is just scarcity on the internet. It can be used for payments. You can buy apartments. You can, if you talk about a world where it's mainly store of value, I'm sure you will be able to buy a lot of things with Bitcoin still. But at the same time, I think it's all about psychology. Do people believe it's valuable or not? So it is kind of the same with Bitcoin and all other Bitcoin forks. I mean, the code is identical except for the block size. There are so many similarities, but I mean, Bitcoin is Bitcoin. That is basically it. And so in that sense, I do think absolutely, if it is a store of value and psychologically people agree on the fact that it is valuable, absolutely. Why not? Now, this is something that many people, I think, do not really get. Like, how can something without value have value? But just the fact that it is global, it is permissionless, it is unconfiscatable, it is up 24/7, and you don't need to be a bank customer to have Bitcoin. Just this basic properties of Bitcoin make it valuable. Like, you just think about the basic properties and you'll understand that it does have value for so many people in the world. And if you live in Western countries, it might be difficult for you to understand. If you live in countries where everything is chaos, you will understand it way more. And even if you just can put some money in Bitcoin and it doesn't get eaten away by inflation. And it's both for poor and rich people. Because rich people are also wondering, hey, I have all of these millions. Can I really move it however I want? How many questions do I need to answer at the bank before I move them? So all in all, I do absolutely think that we don't need to buy coffee with Bitcoin for it to have value. Now, I would love to buy coffee with Bitcoin, and we will still have to see how the market develops. I'm not saying that, you know, Bitcoin should be this or Bitcoin should be that. It's only store value or only transactions. Market will decide. The market will decide. I'm following where it goes, and the future is exciting, to say the least.
Great. So, all right. Well, thanks a lot for that. Last thing before I leave you. Is Bitcoin SV the real Bitcoin?
Absolutely not, man. I don't think so.
Right. Yeah. Well, great. This is pretty much everything that we have time for today. Thank you very much for joining me. And hopefully we can continue that. We can have a follow-up and discuss some other of the aspects of that debate. It was great to have you here, Ivan. Thanks for joining me again. And guys, Ivan has his Good Morning Crypto show, which is starting right now at 8 in the morning Central European time. And so make sure that you check out his channel. I'm going to have the link under in the description box.
Great, man. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed this conversation. It was a very quick chat indeed, and Ivan is quite a fast speaker, but I hope you managed to grasp everything that he was saying, because he had some really quality information there. I know that we are probably still having quite a lot of questions that we haven't really covered. Make sure that you leave a comment below so that I see what kind of questions you have, so that I can address them in my follow-up interviews and chats that I will be doing here on this channel. Also, make sure that you go and follow Ivan on Instagram and on Twitter. The links are in the description box below. Thanks for watching until the end. And if you haven't done that yet, please subscribe to this channel. Click on the bell icon so that you can get notified next time when I'm posting a video. And give me the thumbs up if you like this video. Share it with others. And thanks for staying until the end. I'm gonna see you in the next one.